Okay, while Robin's passing out the paperwork, the gavel's getting twitchy. I'm going to open the hearing on Senate Bill 409, recognize Senator Forsyth, my sponsor. And what's being passed out is, I'm told, a draft amendment from Senator Forsyth.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. For the record, my name is Senator Forsyth from District 4 and the town of Stratford. I think you'll be pleased to know that I'm not going to request that we mandate insurance programs cover medical cannabis. So I'm here to introduce Senate Bill 409. I want to thank my co-sponsors both in the Senate and the House, some of whom are here today. My background is as an Air Force pilot, 12 years, taught at the Air Force Academy. I'm someone who never used marijuana in his life and doesn't plan on starting. That's actually fairly unusual, I think, for my generation. But yeah, 12 years, or actually 16 years of drug testing to prove that. But I do believe six pages, so my motivation is certainly not anything personal in terms of my use or anything. But I do believe sick patients should be able to use it if recommended by their doctors. It's a simple matter of personal choice and personal freedom. My goal with this bill is to have a true medical marijuana bill to help sick patients not have backdoor legalization as California has done. I think that's put a really bad name on the funding movement. And when we mix these two, like California has done, we jeopardize access for patients in this state and in other states because people see it as backdoor legalization. So, want a true medical marijuana bill, and this is an issue that does cross party lines. Conservative Republicans can support it, since it honors the doctor-patient relationship and it's a limited-government approach. Democrats support it, it's a compassionate approach and it respects civil liberties, not to stereotype one side or the other, but it does cross party lines. Last session, after numerous years voting against it, the Senate passed a Lyme disease bill, and that allowed doctors to use long-term antibiotics, and as I remember, that was a unanimous vote. I supported it, that co-sponsored that bill for the same reason I'm sponsoring this bill this year. The approach we're taking for this legislation is different from the one we took last year. The plan in this bill is to have IV cards issued to patients and potentially a dedicated caregiver if the patient can't cultivate marijuana themselves. And that would give legal protection to the patients to cultivate cannabis or to have their caregiver do it. Strictly for the patient's medical use. There are strict rules on qualification. There's a single patient per caregiver, and no profit allowed. I have met with the Attorney General's office, the Attorney General, the State Police, Head of the State Police, and the Chief of Police Association. I'm very thankful to all of them for the time they spent with me, especially Chief Creighton. I had, over a two-hour conversation on the topic, and I got some really good feedback. These organizations are all likely to still oppose this bill, probably under any circumstance, but I, as the bill sponsor, worked fairly hard in terms of getting their feedback in terms of concerns on safety issues. There are philosophical issues we may disagree on, but I think we all agree that we need to implement a bill that keeps New Hampshire citizens safe or, if possible, improve safety. One of the issues that's driven this change, the change in the tactic away from having dedicated care facilities, is not wanting to violate federal law. That's something when I met with the Attorney General, they really highlighted. And also talking to HHS that they highlighted, is having state employees involved in a program puts them potentially at risk for violating federal law. So the treatment centers are eliminated in this legislation. Another reason for that was concern because some of the recent federal raids against care centers in other states. But they have said they are not going after patients. And so that's why we're using the current approach rather than care centers, one of the reasons. The current bill does not require violation by federal law, of the federal law, by anyone, by any state employees. Instead, it sets up a state law, and as we know, the local law enforcement is responsible for enforcing state law, not federal law. So this doesn't put them in necessarily a bad position, because they can't enforce federal law in any case. The other way I look at this bill and this approach is that in talking to law enforcement, most of them will acknowledge that they don't arrest patients. If they know of a sick patient that's truly in need, they will, in general, look the other way. And we've heard testimony in the past about that. But there's problems with that kind of approach. First, it's not consistent across the state. In some towns, you may get arrested. And why should you have less access? Because the local law enforcement treats it slightly differently. It also, I think, puts law enforcement in a tough spot if they're seeing patients that they're having to make an assessment of, is this someone who's in need? Or is it someone who's trying to use this as an excuse? It can be hard for them to tell. And I don't think that's a judgment call they should have to make, because that's not the business they're in. The other problem is there's not a clear distinction between use for medical use versus selling. If you find a patient who is using for medical reasons, and you think you might want to look the other way, are they also selling? Are the marijuana plants in their house also going to other people? That can be unclear. The third, I think, major problem is the current situation rewards illegal drug dealers and adds potential danger to the patients and also to the community. Because if we're going to look the other way and let these patients get cannabis or marijuana, who are they getting it from? Right now, by definition, they're getting it from someone who's an illegal dealer. So this bill makes the current non-arrest policy that many people see across the state consistent across the state. It puts the doctors in charge of assessing the need rather than the police. It increases safety for the patients and the communities by removing the criminal element in the process. It provides regulation on where and how the cannabis can be stored, when it can be transported, and draws a clear distinction between medical use. So, in terms of protections that are in the bill, there's a strict list of conditions that limit eligibility in terms of health conditions. This is one of the more restrictive lists in the country. It's not a California list. It's very different. PTSD is listed in there, and that is one that could be subjective. However, it does require a psychiatric evaluation. The other thing that we put in there for protection is that you must have an established relationship with a doctor who is recommending the use, and you have to have that relationship for at least 3 months prior to getting that recommendation. So this is actually stronger protection against doctor shopping than we see in controlled substances. You know, if you were trying to fish around for somebody who would prescribe you, you'd have to go to a bunch of people, wait 3 months for them to agree with you. The doctors do have to be eligible to prescribe controlled substances. This isn't just necessarily any family doctor. For PTSD, you have to see a psychiatrist. There's also a criminal record check for the caregivers. You can't be a caregiver if you've had any record of drug use. It adds a felony charge for any registered patient or caregiver who gives to anyone else that's not part of this program. So that's an added protection. We also made it so it's one patient per caregiver, I mentioned, and only expenses can be reimbursed. You can't reimburse yourself for labor, so there's no profit motive. If it's only one-to-one patient, this is not something you can get wealthy on. All you can do is get your expenses back. You can't serve more than one patient. So these are true caregivers, not drug dealers. I do have an amendment, 1160, that I'll introduce. This was partially based on conversations that I had with Chief Brady. And like I said, this doesn't mean he's going to support the bill, but I did want to make sure I addressed concerns that he had. A couple of changes are not part of that. The first is we removed a licensed healthcare professional as being someone who has any different qualifications to be a caregiver. In the original bill, if you're a licensed healthcare professional, you could serve more than one patient. But there's really no reason to feel that these folks are any more qualified to cultivate cannabis than anyone else. That was based on an old committee recommendation, so I thought it was appropriate to take that out. So now nobody can serve more than one patient. OWL also made some changes for readability that are just minor, but it moves stuff around if you're looking at it, and it looks quite different. But the changes we did for safety, based on safety input, is we added a cultivation location to the registry. We were going to put it on the card, but then someone pointed out that if you have the cultivation location on the card and the kid finds the card for some reason, he lost it, then they can go and find that location. So instead, it's private information in the registry, but the local law enforcement can contact HHS or get access to the registry. If they happen to see a couple of marijuana plants and they suspect that they're being used for non-medical use, they'll know whether or not that is a valid location. We also placed a restriction then, now that we defined a location, that the larger limits of 6 plants, 6 ounces, and 12 seedlings, which are what you need in order to grow the marijuana for the patients, that limit is at the cultivation location. You can't have that anywhere else. So that ensures that one caregiver or one patient doesn't have multiple spots and is using this as a way to sell to others. And then we drop the limit then on how much you've got elsewhere, where you can only have 2 ounces of marijuana elsewhere. So, and this is as high as it is, because this, in some cases, you'd have to go see the caregiver once a week, depending on how much you use. It might be as up to only once a month. We added, on his recommendation, a fine, $100 fine if you, if the patients don't, or the caregivers don't have their ID on them when they're found in possession. They're going to get let off anyway, but it causes the police extra effort in order to track down, figure out if they are a valid patient, and there should be some repercussions for that. And we will add, based on his recommendation, a size limit on the marijuana plants. Someone did point out that, or Chief Craig pointed out that you can grow them quite large, and that's certainly not the intent. The intent is to only have enough to satisfy the patient's needs and no more. And so we'll add a size limit in addition to the number limit. And 100 square feet is what we use based on research. The other thing I want to point out, and if you have a handout on Police Chief's response to SB 409, I've had my intern RJ start calling the police chiefs kind of randomly, and he's in the audience if there's any questions on the response that he's gotten. He's going to continue to do that for a little bit until the next hearing. And if you look at this, he called 30, he got through to 11, and there's a mixed response. There was one chief that was in support. He took the position that a profession supported, then who's he to say? Maybe he supported that. Three chiefs were neutral on it, have concerns about the distribution and the implementation, but was supported with the medical professionals. Say it has medicinal qualities, and we'll hear testimony of that today. We heard it last year. There were five in opposition. So a little, slightly less than half outright opposition. But even they would say they'd entertain it if the practice became accepted by the medical community. And then chiefs without position two, one of which said, well, I really don't want to speak to this while I'm on duty. So the opposition amongst law enforcement is not universal. I would certainly urge for all of you to contact some of your local police chiefs and see how they feel about it. This survey was anonymous, so I can't tell you if it's were from your district. But certainly not universal agreement. And the thing I will point out is in states that have legalized this responsibly, usually the law enforcement afterwards has turned around and said, this really isn't the end of the world. It has not been as bad as we thought it was. The other thing I want to highlight is this isn't a big political risk. Over 70% support, and I believe you should have some poll results on that. And it crosses party lines. It differs amongst party lines, but there's majority support across party lines. In my opinion, it's getting to be at this point where the bigger political risk is not passing this legislation. When there's families who have family members with cancer or in need, I think this can be quite risky to start to continue to vote against this. The thing I want to emphasize is I am completely open to feasible suggestions from law enforcement or anyone else on improving safety concerns. I did just have recently a conversation with HHS, and I apologize for not having spoken to them earlier. They may have some good recommendations in terms of how to get the program started funding-wise from private donations, and also some concerns about the database, the Class B misdemeanor, if you give out information falsely, which could put some of them on the spot. So we're willing to change those. Some of the things we can't change is we can't have hospitals distributed. I know the governor has asked for that, but I'm sure he knows that that's impossible to do. But we can't ask them to violate federal law, which regulates drug usage in hospitals and pharmacies. We do want to avoid dispensaries, and I've got feedback from HHS that they like that because that keeps them from being on the spot in terms of administrating this. Even though I can see that it would be could be better for patients rather than the hassle of them getting a caregiver or cultivating it themselves. And I also ask that we don't use safety concerns as an argument to defeat this bill, because I am willing to look at safety concerns and make any improvements that we need to. The patients have been waiting long enough. This is not California or Colorado. We get to see a lot of press about them. You don't hear about the other states that have legalized this, but it's going quite well in those states. It is not causing problems, including our neighbors, Maine and Vermont. It's an extremely responsible bill. California has 1 in 20 residents as patients, quote unquote patients. And they get all of this bill. Vermont has similar restrictions as that we have in this bill. And they only see around 500 patients statewide. This is not a law that will create chaos. It will reduce suffering for patients. And I welcome any questions. Thank you.
Senator Sanborn.
Mr. Chair, Senator, thank you very much. If you could comment on two questions which I recently raised to you at one point. Obviously, there's a pretty big departure here between dispensaries, not a grow your own. There seems to be a lot of controversy about allowing people to grow their own or have a character versus a dispensary. Is there any other capacity that could bring some level of comfort to people who are concerned about when, where, and how it's being grown? And number two, concerns about operating machinery or driving cars without the capacity to test for the levels. As we know, we have the issue levels of two, you know, with our DWI laws that you have some capacity to test for a level of incapacitation. And that continues to be a challenge that I'm dealing with marijuana. Be fun on the call for those reasons.
Sure. You know, in terms of having something like a care facility, I mean, the problem really there gets into is once you have something that can serve multiple patients, now you have, you know, a large quantity together. And so you need to regulate it fairly heavily. You know, and then you've got the state involved in that regulation, which opens them up to scrutiny under the federal law. And then also, you know, we have the issue of the federal government starting to raid some of those facilities. So I don't know a good way around that. But one thing I did want to mention that I didn't really put in the bill is that the plants have to be locked up, and the marijuana at the cultivation facility has to be locked up in an enclosed area to keep it safe. And out of other people's hands. In terms of machinery, I mean, we face that issue with things other than marijuana currently, even legal medications. You know, you can be driving under the influence of those. That is illegal. That the police will have to look for that just as they do now with any of those other medications in terms of a field sobriety check, which, you know, can cover other things rather than just alcohol. I mean, but yeah, you can't do necessarily blood tests. This bill does make it explicitly clear that operating under this law does not exempt you from all those laws, such as operating heavy machinery. And that's explicitly in here, that we single that out as among, you know, driving codes, the whole list. There's a big laundry list of things that we make it clear that this does not opt you out of. And I probably can't put my finger right on that. So. Especially since I have HB 309.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate you.
Senator Deep.
I have a question. Thank you very much. This is well thought out. And I think medical marijuana in some form should be available to patients immediately. My problem is my concern is people growing it themselves. In our drug inventory that is administered to the public now, a great many of those drugs are made from plants and herbs already. And pharmaceutical companies process the plants and herbs and put them in various forms for people to use. Why don't we allow pharmaceutical companies to process this cannabis and distribute it like they do with any of the other drugs that are prescribed for people's use to relieve pain,
suffering? Thank you, Senator Wallace. That's a good question. I mean, one of the reasons is in terms of effectiveness, you know, I guess there's Marinol that they try to market that just simply isn't as effective. But in terms of marketing, you know, having the pharmaceuticals do it in some other way that's more effective and maybe a more direct use of the plant, the federal government won't allow them to do that. So unfortunately, I mean, that would be the good answer, is the federal government to say, will allow the pharmaceuticals to do these things. I mean, they've been restricting research on this, so it's actually, you know, it's kind of fairly hard to get the data, but they are finally, the federal government is doing a very limited research study on it to see its effectiveness. And the VA hospitals have now said, we are not gonna take patients out, veterans out that are using marijuana for medicinal purposes, so that they've started to look the other way. But that would be the good answer, is to have the federal government, you know, wise up and do this properly. But in the absence of that, I think is a state of responsibility to act to help patients in this state as we can.
Thank you.
Senator Lambert.
Jim, I don't know if you've got the answer to this. Maybe there might be somebody out there that can. You seem to know a lot about this. But this is the first I've heard of marijuana helping PTSD. As you know, Iraq and Afghanistan, we've got just thousands of guys and gals coming back with PTSD. I just hope we're not going to create this class where that's how we're going to treat these folks.
Well,
it's just immediately out.
Yeah. No, that's an excellent question, and some of the people that come out of you can speak to that probably better than I can. But what I can say is that the current best line of treatment for PTSD has been shown to be no better than placebo. That's the current recommended medication. And that medication, I can't remember what the class of medication is, but it's probably something with more side effects than marijuana has. Meanwhile, Israel, for their veterans, uses medical marijuana to treat their veterans for PTSD. And correct me if I'm wrong on that.
That's correct.
Seeing no further questions, Senator Forsyth.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I next recognize Senator White.
And by the way, page 5, on the amendment, page 5, starting line 28, is the list of those things.
The record, Senator Ray White from District 9. I won't do the technical presentation that Senator Forsyth did up, but I'm pleased to hear there's done so much work on the bill. And I also recognize that those of you who have been around a while heard this thing ad nauseum, probably had enough. I can tell by the look on Senator Bradley's face, he sure had enough. But the fact of the matter is,
I'm in favor.
But the fact of the matter is, we're going to keep hearing this until we do something about it. Because I consider myself a pretty conservative, a Republican, and a law enforcement kind of guy. But the fact of the matter is that there's a human element here that can't be ignored, and I think needs to be addressed. When I ran for office, I was asked a lot about my position on marijuana, and so I really divided that question into three parts. I said, if you're talking about medical use, I'm definitely willing to have a conversation. If you're talking about decriminalization, probably not. If you're talking about legalization, definitely not. And that's how I used to answer that question. And when I came up here, really my views evolved. A big part of that was last year when we heard this bill, as you recall. A fellow that I kind of engaged with was named Clayton that came to the Senate debate on that, and I got really involved with him and quite moving, really, hearing his whole story. But even beyond that, in my own business relationship, I have a CPA. If I named him here in this forum, I guarantee people would know him. He's a pretty high-profile guy, and he's got lymphoma. And he's told me, now this is a law-abiding middle-class family, like in fact upper middle-class family. These are salt of the community kind of people, pillars of the community kind of people. He says to me, Ray, you know, I get nauseous, nothing else will work, and it's disgusting that I have to turn my kids into my suppliers and put them at risk legally, but that's where I'm at. I mean, this is a responsible person in the community. There's people like this out there, that this is what works. All drugs have side effects and stigmas. I personally, I had a stroke in 2007, a lot of you know that. I believe that stroke was caused by the drug Avandia. I can't prove that, but that's a well-known side effect of Avandia. And drugs are dangerous. All drugs have danger. All drugs have some stigma. And really, we wouldn't even be having this conversation if marijuana didn't have the stigma that it does. But the fact of the matter is, it's like any controlled substance, it's got good and bad. And what we're talking about here is trying to create a framework that it's used for the good and keep away from the bad. When I think of the side effects of some of the drugs that are available today, they're extremely significant. All you have to do is watch the commercials. If you're watching the ABC News with Diane Sawyer. She wouldn't even be on the air without drug commercials. And they always have the laundry list of the side effects, and some of them are pretty horrendous. Let's face it, marijuana doesn't have many of those side effects. I think we're talking about a fairly benign drug, and if it wasn't for the stigma of marijuana, again, we wouldn't have to be having this conversation. So I will, in the interest of being brief, because I know you all had a long day with the previous hearing, and again, somebody like Senator Bradley's heard this about 100 times over the last 10 years. It's time. That's the bottom line. It's time. Most of us that were elected in the wave of last time were pretty libertarian-minded in our outlook. I think that's a safe thing to say. And like Senator Forsyth said, I think this does cross party lines. It's just time to accommodate people that don't have an answer for nausea and a host of other types of symptoms. Think about it, the drugs that we use today. Think about morphine. That has the side effect of potential addiction, but nobody wants to remove that as a useful drug. Think about OxyContin and all that around that, Percocet. A host of painkillers have issues with them, but we understand that people, pain is a terrible thing, and suffering is a terrible thing. We allow people access to those drugs. Let's do the same here for medical marijuana. Time to do it.
Questions? So there's some other way. Thank you very much. Representative Merrick.
Gentler approach, but I also will ask you to indulge me if you mind. I do have written testimony from a physician who may answer a lot of questions, especially ones that many of the chiefs of police had. And it's a brief two-page testimony. If I may read that after mine, would that be okay? Thank you. Okay. For the record, I am Representative Evelyn Merrick, and I represent Coas District 2, which is up north and includes 9 towns. As I said, I will keep my testimony brief. You all know that I am a cancer survivor. I am serving my sixth year of my third term, thanks in large part to a brief yet life-saving experience with medical cannabis. Sadly, I am still in the company of many seriously ill patients who must rely on this extraordinary, natural, God-given medicine to relieve their suffering because they derive no relief from traditional doctor-prescribed pharmaceuticals. That is why all of us are continuing our work to move this issue forward. Over 78% of New Hampshire citizens agree with our effort to allow legal safe use of medical cannabis for doctor-approved qualifying patients. Today is at least the third time that a bill of the nature of SB 409 has come before the House, the Senate, this committee, and it is here because this is a health care concern. HB 648, if you remember, came within 2 Senate votes of a veto override in the early 1980s, I was going to say 1800s, that's probably true then too, but in the early 1980s, medical marijuana was legal in the state of New Hampshire under the leadership of a Republican-led legislature and a Republican government. Why? Because people know it works, and because every one of us must acknowledge that pain and suffering know no boundaries, show no favoritism, no party affiliation, nor discriminate against any age. I cannot think of a greater gift that you could offer your constituents than that of relief from pain and suffering, and I am hopeful that New Hampshire will finally offer that gift to its sickest citizens without retribution, without judgment, and I'm asking you once again, for the umpteenth time, to help protect these patients, provide them with the ability to minimize suffering without fear. Please pass SB 409 and send a message to the House, to the Senate, and to our governor that providing hope and help when in need is your good gift to those you serve. And I appreciate your time for this brief testimony and will entertain questions.
Thank you very much, Representative. Questions? Thank you.
May I read this testimony from the physician?
You may if you wish to, but I think members of the committee can read it also at their leisure. That's up to you.
Promise me you'll read it. It's very important to hear our physician testimony. Okay, thank you very much.
Next, I'd recognize Representative Jen Coffey.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, honorable members of the committee. For the record, I'm Representative Jen Coffey from Merrimack District 6. For the purposes of disclosure, I am an EMT, a licensed nursing assistant, and I've worked in the medical field for over 16 years. And this may be rehashing from last time, but a refresher for some, but I did want to share with you that in my years of work, I've worked in everything from private care to nursing home to multiple levels of hospital, from the ERs to the ICUs to the oncology. One of my most surprising moments in life was to work in an oncology center and have an elderly lady crying. And that's not unusual to have a patient cry, but you do feel compassion, you want to make them feel better. I went in and I held her hand and tried to comfort her and found out that her distress was that everything that we'd been doing for her didn't help. And her grandson was getting her marijuana. And the guilt on her conscience was about to kill her. She hated herself for it. But she wanted me to give her the magic answer. What do I do? How do I make myself feel better and not do this? I didn't have an answer for her. And that was probably the first indication that I'd ever had personally with the experience of a patient giving me that kind of information. It's not unusual that when you're in the healthcare field, sometimes you run into patients almost like a professional. Well, I gotta tell you, I was eating cheeseburgers and I raised my cholesterol. They kind of start telling me stuff. They have her tell me that plain on my heart. But I think that the most important thing we need to discuss here is we wouldn't be having this discussion if it didn't have this negative connotation to it. That somehow marijuana is innately evil, this plant that somehow grows and continues to grow no matter how you try to extricate it from the world. But what we don't talk about is what our prescription drugs do. And I can tell you, I've taken care of far too many people in the emergency department who have overdosed on prescription drugs. And I don't know about any of you, I can personally tell you from my recent experience with having spinal surgery, the prescription drugs can have really bad side effects. I was put on one drug to try and take care of pain. I had to go on to another drug to take care of the nausea that the pain medicine caused me. Then the pain medicine that they gave me for the nerve pain caused me to have extreme heartburn, so they had to put me on another drug. By the time everything was said and done, I was on two prescription drugs to treat what was wrong with me, three prescription drugs to treat the side effects. For me, thankfully, I finally got things under control. For some people, that's not the case. And that's the important thing to understand is that for some people, you can give them Compazine and it makes them feel better. They're not nauseous anymore. If you give me Compazine, I have what's called a dystonic reaction, which causes a real uncomfortable sensation. For some people, it's anaphylaxis, which can kill them. We give people morphine, but if they give you too much, you'll stop breathing. We give people all kinds of drugs, and I'm sure you've all seen the commercials. We can give you a drug to help your depression, but it might cause you to become suicidal. Read it on the TV screen. But for some reason with this one, which we have no documented case of anybody ever dying from an overdose from. I've personally, in 16 years, never treated anybody for an overdose of it. I can't tell you how many people I've treated for overdosing on Tylenol. It's just the nature of our society and how things work. This is given this negative connotation. The bottom line is it helps patients. The real bottom line is why should government come between a doctor and their patient? No doctor is going to just start willing out these prescriptions. The sky is not going to fall and you're not going to see thousands of prescriptions automatically done. Because no doctor today overprescribes morphine, OxyContin, and all those other wonderful things that we all know can kill somebody at the wrong doses and can kill somebody if they are overused and can be abused by society. Doctors are pretty strict about that stuff. And they're strict about that stuff to protect them, their patients, their licenses. they're not going to suddenly start handing these out like candy. I think it's going to be your extreme. It's going to be your cancer patient. It's going to be your Crohn's patient. It's going to be people that are really suffering. And they're just asking for us to say, okay, I don't know as much as your doctor, but if your doctor thinks this is better for you, then I'm not going to get in the way. As far as some of the other issues, when you talk about driving under the influence and things like that, one of the biggest things that, well, I think law enforcement faces right now is driving under the influence of prescription drugs. Thankfully, they have field sobriety tests. They can tell if somebody's driving erratically. They can tell if somebody is being inappropriate. That's why they pull them over in the first place, likely. But when they get them out of the car and they start running those tests, they know something's up. Same thing is going to apply now. Same way that they do anything else. As far as looking at the way it's procured, hospitals can't bring this in. There's no way. It's not possible. If you really foresee having a greenhouse in the hospital, we have a lot of regulations that we have to stick to, both federally and state. There's no way we're going to be able to put that kind of a thing into a hospital without causing problems. In fact, in some areas of the hospital, you'll find that you're not allowed to have any kind of plant whatsoever because it can cause respiratory issues and be harmful to the patients. So you're not going to want to put this kind of thing in a hospital. Having it, this bill, I think, is one of the best ways I've ever seen it done. Instead of having one primary location that can be targeted, like a CVS for OxyContin, you have the individual patient issue. That one person, those few items for that patient. It's cataloged. We all know it's there as far as the government goes. The police know it's there. It's registered. There's control there. I think it's one of the better control mechanisms I've ever seen. Putting it in a big, large-scale location just encourages problems. We have more robberies in CVS now because of things like OxyContin. People hold up banks because they know they got a lot of money. Well, people are going to hold up a dispensary because they know there's a lot of something there that they want. But if they don't know about you and your house and your couple of little things that are treating you for your care, because everything else that we've given you in medical science either made you worse, or didn't make you any better, you're not going to be the target. And with that, I'll draw a close.
Any more questions? Janet Monahan, Hampshire Medical Society, you got the door early this time.
Thank you.
Neutral.
Yes. Good afternoon again. I'm Janet Monahan from the Hampshire Medical Society. And I kind of planned on coming to the hearing, but in the last few weeks I've received several phone calls and emails and voicemails. Basically saying to me, since the AMA supports medical marijuana, what's the medical society's position? So I just came to give you some documents to clarify that the American Medical Association does not necessarily support medical marijuana, and I just wanted to read this short introductory. Our AMA calls for further adequate and well-controlled studies of marijuana and related cannabinoids in patients who have serious conditions for which preclinical, anecdotal, or controlled evidence suggests possible efficacy and the application of such results to the understanding and treatment of disease. Our AMA urges that marijuana status of the federal Schedule 1 controlled substance be reviewed with the goal of facilitating the conduct of clinical research and development of cannabinoid-based medicines and alternative delivery methods. This should not be viewed as an endorsement of state-based medical cannabis programs. The legalization of marijuana has scientific evidence therapy of human cannabis meets the current standards for a prescription drug product. And I also have included 4 pages from a 60-page report from the American Society of Addiction Medicine. And if you go to page 2, there's just a really short conclusion under the abstract. And again, they're basically saying the FDA needs to look into this, and the process should provide important protections for patients making medications available only when they are standardized by identity, purity, potency, and quality, are accompanied by adequate directions for use and improved medical indication, and have risk-benefit profiles that have been well-defined in well-controlled clinical trials. So we are now taking this to either for or against this bill.
Questions?
Thank you.
David Woody. Tony.
Hey, so, Senator Bradley. Anyone else on the panel? I appreciate your time today. Could you have to pass these out for me? I sit before you today as a leader in my community and this issue. To give you a little bit about my background, I served 22 years in the United States Navy. I was a flight engineer on the airplane called the P-3 Orion, as well as the EP-3 version. If you remember the spy plane incident about 12 or 13 years ago when the U.S. spy plane hit the Chinese fighter and they landed on Hong Kong Island, that was my last squadron. I used to fly those same missions in that very airplane. So I've held a top secret security clearance, and I retired from the Navy as a chief petty officer in 1997. Part of my career, I was stationed at a research and development command right after Gulf War I in Warminster, Pennsylvania, and we were tasked for developing new protective clothing to defend troops from chemical biological attack because Saddam Hussein used sarin gas on some of our people, and those suits that we had back then didn't work very well. A lot of people got hurt. So I answered a call to duty, and I volunteered to be a human test subject and ride in extreme machines to test these suits under combat-type conditions. I used to ride in a centrifuge, spinning around a room, pulling as much as 9 Gs. And that means if you weigh 200 pounds, which I did about the time frame, you now weigh 1,800 pounds. There's pictures on the final page of that pamphlet to show you some of these extreme machines I used to ride in. I also rode in the ejection tower simulator. That's exactly what it sounds like, except it's worse than an ejection because instead of coming down in a nice comfortable parachute, you eject with the same force as an ejection and stop in 150 feet. That's how tall the tower is. And the pictures of the airplane and the flight station give you an idea of what I did for my primary job. And I did that for over 20 years and amassed over 10,000 hours, and I literally flew at the tip of the sword of freedom. For more than a decade now, I have suffered from severe chronic pain stemming from my injuries from those machines. So much so that 8 years ago, I had to start taking narcotics to control my pain. If you look at the MRI pictures on the second to the last page, you will notice every single vertebrae of my neck is horribly damaged. My mid-back, the thoracic area, you can see where the two center vertebrae are smaller than the ones above them because they are crushed. And the low back has a bulging disc and other problems. That's only my spine, not to mention my entire musculoskeletal system that has been severely damaged by these machines. Now, when I started taking those pain pills, I had the belief that they wouldn't hurt me so long as I took them as prescribed and did not abuse them, which I did for the whole time I was taking them. Up until last summer, in that last year, I almost committed suicide twice because my quality of life was so bad, I didn't want to be here anymore. The only reason I'm here today is the love for my wife of 23 years and my 16-year-old daughter, and that's the only reason I'm still here today. Last June, now I had for 18 months plus, I had this chronic cough that would not go away. It sounded like this. That went on for 24/7 for over a year and a half. I had this massive pain in my back on the left side and down my arm I thought was from my spinal injuries and referred pain. When I went to a naturopath doctor last year, because a friend of mine said, Tony, you got to do something differently because whatever the VA is doing for you, it's killing you. And I knew he was right. So I went to this naturopath and he diagnosed me properly. The VA thought I had an asthma. They had me on prednisone. They had me on inhalers. They had me on 120 milligrams of morphine sulfate slow release and 40 milligrams of oxycodone a day. Okay. What had happened, according to the naturopath, was over the years of taking all these medicines and the other medicines for the side effects of the medicines and on, that it had inflamed and toxified, it had toxified my body to the point where my vagus nerve, that's the second largest nerve in the body, It's the largest nerve outside of the spine, goes down through your neck, wraps around all your major organs in your body. It was wrapped around my lungs, was inflamed and irritating my lungs, and that's why I could not stop coughing. The back pain wasn't from my back injuries, although some of it was. The majority of it was because it was wrapped around my heart, and I had been having an 18-month-long low-grade heart attack because of these FDA-approved prescribed medicines that I took as prescribed by my doctor, under supervision, under care at the VA. I knew that they were going to kill me if I didn't, you know, I was a dead man walking and I knew it. Literally, I knew I was a dead man walking. I asked the VA, what does it take to get off these things? Because I don't want to die. They're going to kill me. And they told me, you got to go through a one-week detox program and we're going to put you on methadone and you're going to get off these things in a week. I've been taking these things for over almost 8 years, okay? I knew my body was too weak and my heart especially was too weak to do this in a 1 week time. I instinctively knew that. If I did that and did it their way and took on more medicines, which are all toxic and acidic by nature, then I probably would die of a heart attack. That was my belief. So I detoxed on my own, at home, and I got medical cannabis off the street, which I'm, you know, I was going to say earlier, I'm not proud of that, but I changed that now because now I'm angry that I had to do that. And I've got a 16-year-old daughter who's a close Exeter Academy student, and I was completely above board with my daughter about everything, and she got it. She's a 16-year-old kid. Understands that that was medicine for her father, and if I didn't have it, I was going to die from the medicines that was being provided me by my own government. That doesn't make any sense anymore. Okay, my concern was then, what am I going to do for my body? My injuries didn't suddenly disappear, right? What am I going to do once I get off these pain meds if I can't handle it anymore? I didn't want to be on anything. Never did, okay? But my concern was, how am I going to live with it? I needed these medicines to not be in it. My body had become nothing less than a portable personal torture chamber. That is not an exaggeration at all, okay? At all. I was getting deep tissue massage once a week, which I paid for out of pocket. I was getting acupuncture and chiropractic care, thanks to you, through the VA, which, by the way, they denied for a period of time, saying that they weren't going to offer it anymore because it wasn't intended to be used for long-term purposes for disease prevention, health promotion, and quality of life enhancement. I got my congressman involved on that one, and I got very little help. I asked a lawyer in my own school church, what can I do about this to sue? He said, don't bother, there's no money in it. I was left with nothing else but pain and looking at no future at all. I started detoxing last summer in the middle of July on my own using medical cannabis. It took me 3 weeks. I lost 35 pounds in 3 weeks. I could feel every beat of my heart pounding against, I could feel it and hear it in my ears, pounding against my chest, just struggling for one more beat, hoping it would do it one more time. And I begged God for relief or death. And I almost, more than once during that period, I almost took a whole handful of these pills just to end it all. I almost did it. I still had a bunch of those pills held back because I didn't know what I was going to do afterwards if it didn't work. I had that as a backup. I was going to do it because I didn't have any other options. I fortunately found a new chiropractor who introduced me to this product called ASEA, which is a redox signaling molecule supplement. I know you've never heard of that. And in 6 weeks, my symptoms went away. In 6 weeks, drinking 2 ounces a day, twice a day, 4 ounces of this product. But my point is, I've used medical cannabis to detox off of narcotics. And I didn't, at no time did I have any tremors or sweats or any of that. I knew my body. I gradually weaned myself over a three-week period till I could get off those things and stay off them. And then the past 6 months, that other product I told you has dramatically increased my quality of life, and I don't take any medicines at all anymore. This stuff is being called the greatest advance in medical science in the past 100 years, and it was invented by an atomic medical physicist named Dr. Gary Samuels. And if the VA would use this product, which is not VA approved, FDA approved either, but it's out there, it would save the government an absolute fortune. Because if it can do that for me, it can think about it. But at the same time, I didn't have that stuff at the time when I was detoxing, and I needed the medical cannabis to get off those drugs that they were killing. And nobody should have to go through that. And I was taking these things as prescribed. I had this idea that if I took them as prescribed and it only controlled my pain, that it couldn't hurt me. You know, I was not only wrong, I was almost dead wrong. And I've got a quality of life back now. It's fantastic. My wife has her husband back. My daughter has her father back. I have a nearly normal life now. And I'm rated by the VA. It's 100% permanently and totally disabled. And I used to live that way. But I don't have to anymore. And I hope you guys really take the time to realize that this country is changing. And just because a pharmaceutical company hasn't approved something, or the FDA hasn't approved something, just because it's going through that process doesn't mean it's good for you, okay, at all. And just because it isn't approved that way doesn't mean it's not good for you either. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Tony. Matt Simon, Maryland Policy Progress.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the committee for considering my testimony. For the record, my name is Matt Simon. I live in Gosstown. I work as a legislative analyst for the Marijuana Policy Project. In 2009, I was very involved in this effort with a different position. I organized patients in 2009. I probably spoke to at least 50 patients, most of whom were afraid to come here. I would estimate I've spoken to 100 seriously ill patients in New Hampshire, most of whom would qualify under this bill. And again, most of whom are afraid still to come here and talk about this. So I'm grateful for the sponsors to bring this bill back. I'm grateful for all the legislators that are willing to have this conversation. And I hope this is the year the patients don't have to wait anymore. Falling two votes short in 2009 was tragic for many of them and many of their families. At least one's passed away. At least one has moved to Vermont in order to not live in fear of being arrested. And he's here today to share his story. So what I've given you is a two-page overview of the bill, which I will not read or even refer to because I think Senator Forsyth did a great job presenting it. I do have a handout, the one with the graphs on it, the one with the color. It says, do medical marijuana laws lead to increased rates of teen marijuana use? One of the most common objections that we hear in this debate is that passing a bill like this would send the wrong message to young people. It would give kids the idea that marijuana is medicine rather than being a dangerous drug. So if we pass this, then therefore, obviously, more teens will move on to use marijuana. And the data just doesn't bear that out. It simply doesn't. We have 16 states plus D.C. that have now passed this. Most of those laws have been on the books long enough for there to be before and after data. And if we just look at Northern New England, Vermont passed its law in 2004, excuse expanded the conditions in 2007, so patients have been cultivating marijuana in Vermont since then, and we can see the teen use rate has decreased slightly in Vermont. In Maine, which passed its law in 1999, we see Maine has lower teen marijuana use than both New Hampshire and Vermont, despite the fact that New Hampshire still criminalizes all marijuana possession and use. And in Maine, we estimate they have thousands of patients that are growing marijuana with the program. They don't have a registry, so we don't know for sure. We have two states that don't have a registry. But we estimate that it's in the thousands. And if that can happen, and teen marijuana use continues to drop in Maine, according to the NSDUH study, these are the two major U.S. government studies that have the data on this issue. According to this graph on the second page, Maine's rate peaked in 2004 and has gone down slightly every year since 2004. And in New Hampshire, our rate's gone up slightly the last 4 years. Chief Crate may suggest that that's because we're having this conversation. Maybe it is, but maybe Maine shows what happens once you pass the law. These are very small fractions of a percentage. My belief and the belief of the researchers who have studied this is that when children, teens, are determining whether or not to use marijuana or not, that what's the law is not the question that comes into their mind. You know, we see laws, whether it's decrim or medical marijuana, the before afters, it's more regional factors, social factors, cultural factors. It's not what's the law, how harsh are the penalties, do you allow seriously the patients to use medical marijuana. So the third page of that does show some research and a study that was published in refers to a study that was published in California Pediatrician that concluded similarly. The data are very reassuring that in almost all cases, medical marijuana legalized for adults does not lead to an increase in recreational use of marijuana by adolescents. So if anybody tries to tell you that this sends the wrong message and it's going to cause cancer teens to use marijuana at higher rates, please ask them for data. That's all I ask you to do. I'm presenting written testimony on behalf of John Tomasi. He's on a plane to France this afternoon with one of his classes from Bentley College, where he teaches economics. He's retired as a sergeant from the Salem Police Department and still works as a part-time police officer in Hampton Beach during the summer. I'm just going to read one sentence or two. The alternative to passing SB 409 is to maintain the status quo, and the status quo is that all marijuana possession and use is considered criminal activity in New Hampshire, even for patients battling diseases such as cancer, multiple sclerosis, and glaucoma. I suspect that many members of law enforcement would support this reform if they were in the legislature and had to cast a vote. Some New Hampshire police chiefs may disagree, but from my perspective, SB 409 appears to be a responsibly crafted bill that would protect patients and their families without leading to serious abuses. So thank you for considering Tomasi's testimony. And finally, I don't have enough copies of this for everybody, but I'll give you this one. I do have an op-ed to submit on the issue of PTSD. I'd like to talk about that briefly. The inclusion of PTSD specifically as a condition is not something that states had done previously. It's, New Mexico has, and other states, patients can qualify, but not specifically with PTSD. So this is, we understand something that's added to this bill this year, and if you don't think it's appropriate, you know, no objections. If you choose to remove it, I would understand, but at the same time, we've heard that marijuana is recommended informally, and veterans groups, it's come to my attention, and I've spoken to a lot of veterans about this, that veterans who suffer from PTSD are recommending medical marijuana to each other. They're sharing it with each other. They're using it in New Hampshire. And they're doing that because, as Senator Forsyth said, the leading antipsychotic medicines do not perform any better than placebo, according to all the tests. So it's already happening, and I would personally urge you to consider that and to leave PTSD in the bill. But at the same time, I wanted to be honest about the fact that there's not a lot of research on it. There is a study in Arizona. I've spoken to this doctor several times. She's completely infuriated with the DEA, which will not approve her study on the use of marijuana by the PTSD combat veterans returning suffering from PTSD. The DEA controls every single study. They have to, if you want to study marijuana, you have to get DEA approval to schedule one substance. They do not approve studies. Very rarely do they ever approve a study that seeks to find benefits of marijuana use. Some of the most compelling studies that we've presented in the past are studies that sought to find that marijuana was a harmful, dangerous drug, and then ended up not quite proving that, and they backfired. But there's research being done in other countries. Most of the real research is being done by patients in California and Colorado and 14 other states. They shouldn't be the ones having to do the research. We should be studying it. The FDA should be doing it. Everybody agrees there should be more research. Of course we agree there should be more research. But from a patient's perspective, FDA approval takes a long time, even if there is a change in Washington, which none of us are holding their breath for. And the reality is today there are patients using marijuana in New Hampshire. There are doctors who, in the privacy of the meeting room, are suggesting that this may be the best thing for you. And those doctors are also not here today because they're afraid to say those things. But in some cases, they have recommended marijuana. And yes, that's all I have. I'd be happy to entertain any questions anybody might have on any subject.
Questions, Matt? I would like to call Ted Wright. Had to stop throwing up, and it had to start eating. She was losing a pound every 2 to 3 weeks, which is unsustainable after a while. It really isn't a good thing. So that's pretty much it. I'm in town politics. I've been in town politics for 15 years. I'm the chairman of the budget committee in Tuffenborough, but as a selectman, I'm pretty fiscally conservative. I've run for selectman several times. Actually, Billy Stockman's stepping down this year, but I was a shoo-in, or potentially a shoo-in for the seat, right on his heels. But I'm not doing it this year because this is more of an issue to me. I'm spending too much time with this that I couldn't devote to the town. So I'm trying with the budget committee again. And really, the issue is that I'd like to impart to you is that I've gone in, recently gotten these cards from Matt's office. And these, if I could give these to you, I would appreciate it. Saving the postage, being just so conservative that I am. These are folks from Tuffenborough and Wolfborough, and a couple of them in Moultonborough.
that are behind me. And when I go out and talk to people about what we're going through, and some of them are going through issues of their own, it's overwhelming, the support for this in the community. That's all I can really tell you, that there are a lot of people that are behind you with this, and there are going to be more. I'll get more of those cards for you, if you'd like, because it's become quite a topic. There's really no way to look at it other than this is going to help somebody, or not just one person, but, and the federal government just isn't on board with it. So it's up to us to deal with it ourselves here in the state. All right. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you. Will
Eckhart.
Sorry.
I have testified, you fool aren't. I'm a former hepatitis C patient, and I say former because I have been cured. And marijuana helped me a great deal in that effort when they can't say enough towards the plant. Today I wish to speak because I was prescribed marijuana. Or pharmaceutical, THC, if you want to call it that. And I also use plant-based medicine. And Senator, you spoke of why don't you use pharmaceuticals. So I can address that a little bit. Number one, in herbal medicine, the reason herbalists like the whole plant, because there's a synergistic component to plants. They have lots of components, and all those components work together. Taking one component out of that plant doesn't necessarily work the same way. If you just isolate the THC, which is the more active cannabinoid, that's a large part of what we want. There are other cannabinoids that are very helpful and mitigate actually some of the effects of THC, so it's even more tolerable. Marinol can be quite an overpowering drug to some people. It really didn't bother me in that respect, but I have heard other patients talk about that. I do believe the plant that is better if it's not smoked, which can be done. It can be vaporized, it can be used as extracts or edibles the patient can take versus smoking it. What makes plant-based medicine a better option is quick onset and ability to titrate doses immediately. In my case, during antiviral therapy, I had pain, nausea, vomiting, and anorexia. The anorexia presented with a total distaste for food. This was anorexia, not anorexia nervosa, which is associated with imaging, like too fat sort of thing. This is just total just can't eat, don't want to eat, don't have any motivation to eat. Marinol worked well for this because Marinol is oral, and when you take either plant-based medicine or Marinol orally, it lasts a longer period of time. And so in that respect, it was a good drug for me. The drawback for me was that its onset takes forever. It can take up to 2 hours. You take a pill, it takes 2 hours before it even touches you. So if you're anorexic or nausea or vomiting, 2 hours is a hell of a long time to wait. If you're going to vomit and you take a pill, what's going to happen to that pill? It's going to come out. So therefore, now you don't know, did I absorb some of that medicine before I vomited or did I not? Should I take another dose? Should I not? All these questions come into your mind. Both nausea and vomiting tended to have an immediate onset. I mean, they just spontaneously come on. So it wasn't something I've always had. I could be driving a car and, you know, the next minute I'm falling off the side of the road vomiting. So something having its effect at 2 hours later was not an option for me. Marinol's effectiveness varies a lot. If you vaporize plant-based material, you can titrate it, okay? So I can take a little, that wasn't quite enough, you can take a little bit more. Marinol, you can't do that. You take a pill, was that enough? 2 hours later, well, maybe it wasn't enough, but now do you want to take another pill? No. Both these drugs make you high, no doubt. But I want to talk a little bit about what is that high. When I say that for the most part when you are sick, you are not in the frame of mind necessarily getting high. You're not trying to get high. You're trying to alleviate your problem. If I take OxyContin, it's going to make me high. If I take marijuana, it's going to make me high. But you feel differently than if you're normal in taking these things. So that concept that everybody's trying to get high is ludicrous. We're not trying to get high, we're trying to get better. Another point is that on a lot of other drugs are prescribed, let me say that this bill allows patients to take control of their medicine rather than having to buy it at cost of Croak Street value. I like this bill. Before, you always had the dispensary issue in there. I think, why are we creating an environment where people are profiting off this when it's simple enough to put it in a flower vase and grow the plant, a pot, grow the plant? Why do we need to have large companies? I mean, I do actually agree with the federal government. The people that are trying to make millions of dollars off of this, it's not right. People are sick. We're just trying to get people better. So let's not make an institution out of this. Let's just let the patient be able to take care of themselves. If you're too sick, like when I was on antiviral therapy, I couldn't have grown anything. My mind wasn't there to, the drugs mess up your mind pretty badly. I couldn't have grown, I couldn't have grown sprouts at that time. But having a caregiver be able to do it, that's a good satisfactory way of doing it. And then, if your problem isn't something that, is messing with your mind, then you can probably grow marijuana quite easily. Just a couple of things on the bill itself that I would change, but I think it's a pretty darn good bill anyways. The number of seedlings is kind of low. If you look at it from a horticultural sense, marijuana, there's male plant, female plant. Female plant is the plant that we want to get our medicine from because it has the flower, and the flower is what produces most of the cannabinoids that are beneficial. So I take 12 seeds and I put them in a pot and I grow 12 little plants. Well, six of those out of ratios are going to be male. So now I'm down to my six plants. But, they're easy to grow, but I forgot to, turn on the thermostat today or something. So three of the plants died. Now I'm down to three plants, and I'm allowed to have six when they mature, but I've only got three to grow from. So I just the seedlings aren't going to produce anything that's going to either medically make you better or make you high. So I think your number of seedlings is a little bit on the small side. Maybe 24 would be more something you could live with, and then you could weed out the males and get rid of them. And when things die, you wouldn't be at wit's end because, now I'm not going to have enough medicine. Now I got to go back to the street vendor to get my drugs. And I must say, I've had to use my children to get me drugs too. It is not fair to make people use their children as ways of getting drugs. It's just, it's not good. I can't say how horrible it makes you feel. And if they should have ever gotten in trouble while they were doing it for me, I would have just died. You know, I would have gone to court, obviously, and told them why that child was doing that. And the last thing is, I'd like to state that on a social issue, opioids, Vicodin, OxyContin, methadone, I'm a healthcare worker, I see lots of patients on these drugs. Cannabis works on pain, in particular the kind of pain these drugs treat. But many in our society are getting addicted to these drugs. Cannabis can either eliminate the need for them or decrease the amount needed. There are studies demonstrating this. I believe if we included the indications for use in this bill, that when a physician finds that cannabis may either eliminate or reduce the need for powerful pain medicines, its use is justified. I think this would be the first state that would look at that. I think opioid addiction is a horrible social problem, and I think cannabis remarkably could help us in that problem. That's it. Any questions?
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Next, recognize Ronald Mitchell.
Good afternoon, my name is Ron Mitchell. I'm the one Matt was referring to who had to move to Vermont to get quality medical care. New Hampshire would not make it available. I have a 27-year work injury. Crushed my back at work, carrying something off my workbench, the other guy let go, so I ended up crushing my back. For the first 10 years, it was all conservative care. Surgery and everything they could do. Eventually, as time went on, you know, I had children at that time. You gotta work. No matter what happens, you gotta pay the bills, you gotta feed your kids. So I went against doctor's advice, and I had to work, and that's what I did. And then as time went on, the narcotics started coming. I was up to 600 milligrams of OxyContin, 90 milligrams of fast-acting morphine, and Zoloft, Klonopin for PTSD that I got in Vietnam. And so it goes on and on. Now I got Hep C, I've got all kinds of little goodies in my body. I have degenerative disc disease. It's not going to stop. The pain is not going to stop. It's going to continue. I tried to get, we thought we were going to get medical marijuana 3 years ago. It didn't happen. So I had a small stroke because I tried to get off the narcotics and stuff. And now I have a soft spot in my heart. So at that moment I says, hey, I got to move to where the law is, so I can try this medical marijuana. Because I went to get a morphine pump up north, and I was told they don't give those out no more because those are causing modulators and causing paralyzing people. So that was out of question. And then he says, you ever try marijuana? And I says, not since I was a kid, you know. And he says, well, now they got different stuff, and New Hampshire's planning on passing it. And if you don't mind, I would recommend it for you as treatment. And I said, well, yeah, that's all fine and good, you know. We'll see what happens. Well, you know, like I say, time went on, and then I had to move. I ended up selling my home. I've lived here 17 years. Had to leave my family, all my friends. I had to live alone for a year. So my wife would come up there and get a job, find a job. She'd come on the weekends, take care of me. But then I did get the relief that I wanted. Now I'm down to 200 milligrams of medication, but
given time,
I will give that up too. And as you know, as far as my pain, I'm at a level 5, which is a miracle because I used to run at 7, 7.5, 8, and you can't even think when it gets that bad. You can't drive, you can't think, you don't want to talk to people, and you're very unsociable. Your life becomes about that big. Nobody wants to talk to you. Nobody wants to see you. Everybody wants you out of their sight. And so the doctors too. So, you know, it comes to a point, quality health care. We can take care of it ourselves if given a chance with the medical marijuana. It does work, and I'm here to prove it. I'm alive. I am not dead yet. It will come. But with the grace of God, and hopefully I won't be in so much pain that I do it myself. But so far, my pain is down to a 5. That's been 25 years since that's happened. For the last 2 years, I have been living very comfortably, very happy, and very, very comfortable. My family's dead, my kids love me. But also I want to bring up the move. My wife lived here her whole life. Now she's on antidepressants because she had to leave her family to go to a state that had the quality that appeared that I needed. Because life on narcotics is no life. And we all know that. And people who are in pain do not take this drug lightly. Any of them. They're all deadly. As far as, you know, those. Like you said, marijuana has never had a reported overdose. So therefore, you know, I think that should carry a little weight right there. As far as kids I know have more dope than any adult I've ever met. So, you know, as far as keeping away from the kids, we're 40 years late on that. You know, so we can just, you know, if we can just take care of our sick and give them quality health care, I'm sure people with attitudes about things would change. No more dividing, this and that, and, you know, nobody getting along with anybody, you know, and that's what's been going on for the last 3 years. So, you know, I said what I had to say, and thank you for listening, and I hope you don't take that, you know, this lightly. It's a very, very serious health problem across the nation. And people are dying every day without the use of it. Suicide's up 40% in Canada. Give you an idea. Any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. Thank you. Next, I'm going to recognize Claire Ewell.
My name is Claire Ewell. I'm the executive director of the New Hampshire Civil Liberties Union. And like so many of the people in this room, we're back again. And we'll keep coming back until we get it right. I think that Senator Forsyth has put together an extraordinary bill. And I have just a few suggestions for things that I think improve an already good bill. I will read them if I may. They are brief. And I will finish getting hen scratching conferred to readable prose and give it to the clerk. I would suggest on page 5, lines 8 and 9, and you will excuse me, but I have 4 copies of the bill, and only one of them is the copy that has binders. I would add the following language at the end of line 9 on page 5. Delete, nor shall it prevent the sharing of information if the primary offense is unrelated to marijuana. And substitute, add, and the qualifying patient or designated caregiver has given permission to the department to share the information. if the person has probable cause to believe, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, has probable cause to believe that the individual is distributing marijuana to a person who doesn't permit it, the information should only be shared if the patient is informed and gives consent. Because what you will set up if you simply allow the police to be notified is you then put somebody's name on a list. You then, in essence, out somebody who is a medical marijuana patient recipient, and that individual will then be at a higher level for search and intrusion than anyone else in the community. And so I would urge that, first of all, that that change be made to the bill. On page 9, I would suggest that line 17 delete all words after information obtained pursuant to this chapter, put a period, and delete line 17, lines 18, line 19. 18, 19, and 20. And substitute for that language, because the suspicion of an employee at HHS is entirely insufficient to generate notice of the potential of a crime. I would suggest that the language say instead, the employee should record a suspicion to counsel for the department, who will then make a legal determination that the suspicion of the employee constitutes probable cause. You are saying that police be notified on the basis of an individual without legal background who has a suspicion which is nothing close to probable cause. And I think you need to establish legal standards if you're going to break the confidentiality that you've very carefully constructed in this bill. And on page 10, which is the entire section of an affirmative defense, I would suggest that the committee strike everything starting on line 2. Because affirmative defense simply means you are allowed to raise it. It does not in any way mean the jury is required to consider it. You may raise it as an affirmative defense, but you can still be convicted. And I don't think that is the intent of the language on page 10 in this bill. I would suggest that you substitute starting on line 2, in any prosecution of an offense involving marijuana intended for medical use, if, and then leave lines 4, 5, and 6 as are stated in the bill, leave lines 7, 8, and 9 as are stated in the bill, leave lines 10, 11, 12, 13 as are stated in the bill, and then add the language, then the charges shall be dismissed with prejudice. I thank you, Mr. Chair, for the opportunity to bring these items to your attention. But even if you ignore every single word that I have said, I will not be offended. That happens to me in this legislature from time to time. But I would urge that you pass this good bill onto the House. There is one question that you need to ask yourselves, and that is, if not now, when? And the answer to that question is, it is time. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Clerk.
I'm going to give you everything that I said to the clerk.
Work with Robin on that.
All right, okay.
Suggestions and the placement of all those suggestions in the bill, and we'll consider them.
I thank you very much, Senator.
Thank you.
Are you working off of the amendment that is 11?
I have not seen the amendment, Senator. I'm working on the bill as it is.
When you were doing the numbers, it was...
The numbers were wrong.
Yeah, right.
What I'll do is I'll get a copy of the amendment, type up all of the changes, and get them to you.
Very good. That will work well. Thank you very much. The next speaker that I have is Kurt Mendel. Kurt, how am I pronouncing your last name?
It's McNeil. I have terrible handwriting.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Kurt McNeil, and I'm with the New Hampshire Coalition for Common Sense and Age Compassion. I have some historical information here for you guys, but it's getting late in the afternoon. I recognize that. So let me breeze through this, and I'll leave copies for everybody. Just quickly to touch on a couple of things. In 1970, the Controlled Substances Act passed, created schedules for drugs, and empowered the FDA and the Justice Department to enforce those drug laws. Marijuana was provisionally placed on Schedule 1, pending a recommendation from President Nixon's National Commission on Marijuana Drug Use. In 72, the commission published a report that recommended that marijuana use should be discouraged, but not criminalized under federal law. But that report was just sort of swept under the rug and was ignored. This is regarding recreational use, not medicinal use, but I think it's very important because when we talk about federal regulation and federal law regarding any type of marijuana use, this is what we all go back to, is that 1970 ruling, which said we're going to accept it provisionally based on a report. The report was generated, but no changes were ever made. I'll leave you with documentation on all of these things. In 1988, after a couple years of hearings, the DEA Administrative Law Judge, Francis Young, ruled that scheduling standards, which put marijuana on Schedule 1, should be changed to move marijuana from Schedule 1 to Schedule 2. He added, marijuana in its natural form is one of the safest therapeutically active substances known, and it would be unreasonable, arbitrary, and capricious for the DEA to continue to stand between those sufferers and the benefits of the substance. I'm reading that to you today because the difference between a Schedule 1 drug and a Schedule 2 drug is the difference between being able to easily do trials and not to easily do trials. It's the difference between the FDA approving those trials and physicians being able to conduct clinical trials and then not being able to do that. According to both the 10th Amendment and the New Hampshire Constitution, this state has both the legal right and a moral obligation to make decisions regarding the needs of their citizens. The current iteration of this bill separates New Hampshire state employees from federal entanglements. It allows patients who meet the requirements of the legislation to grow their own medicine or grown for them by a caregiver, sidestepping the problems that we see in other states with federal law and federal law enforcement. The bill returns medical decisions to their proper province. It makes it a matter between patients and their doctors where the most current research science can be brought to bear in the most appropriate. Just a couple of other quick remarks. One thing that comes up from time to time in an argument against any type of medicinal marijuana is the idea that marijuana will be prescribed for all sorts of things. This bill is very restrictive as to the conditions that it can be prescribed for, and I think it's important to note that in a proper doctor-patient relationship, a doctor is going to talk to that patient, understand their condition, and there are provisions in this bill where there has to be an established doctor-patient relationship. The doctor's not necessarily going to prescribe one particular medication for high blood pressure as opposed to a regimen of diet and exercise or whatever the case may be. A doctor under these circumstances is not necessarily going to prescribe marijuana for nausea, for glaucoma, or for whatever else the case may be. There's a lot of leeway here for doctors to make their own decisions, but to make those decisions that are appropriate for their patients. I encourage this law. I think it's a very, very strong law, very good for the people in the state of New Hampshire. And it sends the right message to all of our citizens. I want to make two other quick remarks based on things that were said earlier today. One is based on driving under the influence in DUI situations or DWI situations. Breathalyzer tests are now so common that you can buy them online and have them yourself in your jacket pocket when you go to the bar so that you make sure that you don't leave the bar intoxicated. They are so common because we have laws against driving under the influence. If you want to have a quick, easy, and valid test for driving under the influence of a drug, you make that drug taxed and regulated. You make it something that is commonly available, and the companies will scramble over themselves to provide a test that law enforcement can use because they know that law enforcement will buy that test. confusing. Can't fight the market, that's how you get a test. Quick note regarding PTSD and traumatic brain injuries as far as they address veterans. That is something that we're seeing commonly. Cannabis is something that has been used to treat them. It's certainly not the only thing that's being used, but it's one more tool in a bag of tricks, and it would be, I think, very beneficial to our veterans if the VA here in New Hampshire were able to use that as one of those tools. I have several friends who are veterans who have come back with traumatic brain injuries and PTSD. They tell me the difference between being able to use marijuana and being able to use some of the other substances they can describe is the difference between going on disability and being able to work a job, not operating heavy equipment, but in a call center or a desk-type job. But they're able to come back and be gainfully employed and contribute to their families and contribute to society when they're able to use a substance like marijuana, as opposed to being in a situation where they really have to be on disability because they can't do much of it because of the strength of the drugs that they prescribe. That's all I have, unless there are any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Steve. Any questions? Thank you very much. The next person wishes to speak. Dennis, action?
Action.
Action. Thank you.
Senators, thank you for your time. My name is Dennis Ackland. I live in Fremont. You've heard a lot of this before. I'm a cancer survivor. I had a positive experience with medical marijuana after my prescribed pharmaceuticals didn't work. And I kept going back to my doctor and asking him to do something else that he could try because I was still receiving radiation directly from my abdomen. I was very nauseous. I lost my appetite. And he's like, well, try this, try this. Each one was a more expensive, more powerful pharmaceutical. Finally received relief when a friend of mine who survived breast cancer said, try this, and I did. I hadn't even thought of trying it. I was skeptical at first, but soon enough, I was only using small amounts of marijuana in place of anything else during my the highest doses of radiation and the cumulative effects of that. So, but you've heard this all before. I mean, we're not here to try to prove whether it works or not. Skip up to the last year, I was diagnosed with glaucoma. So now, obviously, and the doctor told me it's advanced, I've already had significant damage to my my optic nerve, and so I basically was told I'm going blind. This was disconcerting because after surviving testicular cancer, a miracle with my wife and I, we had our first child. I'm 45 years old, and I'm a stay-at-home dad for an 8-month-old baby now. Total miracle, but I do want to see her grow up and succeed in life and so forth. So now I haven't had the nerve to talk to my eye doctor about medical marijuana yet, and we can't. He can't speak about it because he would lose his license and it's not legal. So I don't want to try it. I don't want to get back into that. I already went through it once. So the outcome of this bill really will determine whether I can go to my doctor and have a frank discussion on what can help me. Right now, I'm taking drops that cost $2 each per dose, $2 a drop. I have to take these drops the rest of my life. The side effects are they burn, a very strong burning sensation in my eye. And I once had nice blue eyes and then turned them brown. So minor, but I mean, still, it's a side effect that's unfortunate. I also received yearly radiation treatments in my eye. I feel like I got hit with a fastball in my eye like that. Now, will medical marijuana help me reduce? Maybe I won't have to take the drops as much. Maybe I won't have to take the laser as much. I don't know. If we move forward on this bill, I will be able to talk to him about that and have that discussion. Maybe it will work, maybe it won't. I feel is something that I should be able to talk to him about without the interference of government. So that's basically all I want to say. Finally, the reason why I support this bill, and I'm a conservative Republican. It's not normally, it takes a lot of courage to be a Republican to come out and talk about this. You guys know it's difficult to speak about because of the misconceptions and so forth. But what I think is the key to this bill is that the profit motive has been removed from this entirely. No one is going to come into New Hampshire thinking that they're going to try to manipulate the system and become pot growers. Because for instance, like in, say, Massachusetts right now, growing up to 50 marijuana plants is considered a misdemeanor. Now, in any cultivation in New Hampshire is a felony. So if someone wants to grow marijuana, they will go to Massachusetts where they can grow it for a certain amount as a misdemeanor and then carry a certain amount as a misdemeanor. Whereas up here, it's a big penalty. And also with the penalties for breaking the rules in this program and being a felony, there's really the disincentives are in place so that no one's going to come up here and try to mess around. But I don't personally know that. Now, as a prospective patient in this new program, I and other people who are either currently using medical marijuana or may in the future, if they're allowed to, we want this program to work. We don't want profiteers or potheads coming in from other places to ruin this program so that the people who really need it can't get it. I have a skill set that can help. I look forward, since I'm a stay-at-home dad, I have time to help with Health and Human Services as far as building the communications that we needed to communicate with patients, facilitating the sharing of information, the best practices, and also compliance. People need to know what the rules are. I'm going to learn this bill inside out, and I will help other people so that they won't have any of the problems that could happen if they don't follow the rules. So compliance is a big part of that as well. And that's something that I would like to get involved with. As far as PSTD goes, my best lifelong friend got back from Afghanistan and has fallen, subsequently put a bullet in his head. He couldn't take it. When I spoke to him, he said that, you know, there was roadside bombs that had gone off that was meant for him, and instead it killed a sidewalk full of women and children. He couldn't deal with that. The VA was all right about things, but wasn't that responsive, and he chose the path that he did. If we could stop that from happening, then we have to try it. We have to try this. And as I said before you, I will do whatever I can to help this program succeed. And I think there's a lot of people who feel that way. So please, if you give us the opportunity as patients to move forward with this program, we will realize that the work that people have put into it, we'll try to help the medical marijuana program to succeed without problems. The best case scenario would be, this will be the last time you have to deal with it, you approve it, and all you hear occasionally is successful outcomes, good stories about it. That's our goal for this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Mr. Kelly, Robert Kelly.
Thank you. I will be brief. The last two pages of a large print edition.
Good afternoon. I should say good evening, Senators and ladies and gentlemen. My name is Robert Kelly. I'm a 60-year-old disabled retiree. I worked for 44 years in the telecommunications industry and earned my place at Who's Who in America. I am recently disabled by peripheral artery disease, but also suffer from AIDS, diabetes, glaucoma, cataracts, macular degeneration, arthritis, and coronary artery disease. I take over 25 pills a day and try to exercise daily. When I was first diagnosed with AIDS in 1996, the cocktail, multi-drug therapy, and the disease itself caused my appetite to wane. From youthful inexperience, and some might say indiscretion, I knew of the munchies. So I asked my doctor if I could try a synthetic drug, marijuana. Unfortunately, it was ineffective. Now I was faced with a dilemma, to either break the law by using contraband marijuana to effectively stimulate my appetite, or continue to lose strength and weight by struggling with my anorexia. I cite the Fifth Amendment on my actual decision, but I ask each one of you on the committee to consider how you would decide. The expensive synthetic drug Marinol contains only one of the active ingredients contained in botanical marijuana, and that ingredient was ineffective for me. In contrast, the herb that can be grown in your backyard is very effective and less costly. Additionally, it was once a common weed and crop in New Hampshire. Was there widespread abuse when this was the case? I live in New Hampshire because, to me, New Hampshire has always been a place where you can walk freely, where government intrusion is minimal, where neighbors are neighborly, and where the general court truly reflects the sentiments of the electorate. In this case, evidenced by the previous bill vetoed by the governor. The bill before you puts responsibility clearly in the hands of the individual patients and caregivers, and not into for-profit enterprises. Senators, I ask each of you to cast a favorable vote on this bill and advance the right of patients to grow, tend, and use a simple but effective plant to alleviate their ills and improve their condition. Thank you very much for your time. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Thank you, sir. Any questions?
Thank you very much, Senators.
I would next recognize Anastasia McDougall. Doctors are not immune to mistakes, and in some cases, they're not reviewing medical records. Lastly, we should not circumvent the FDA as this legislation does. We urge you to vote this bill expedient to legislate. Allow drugs to be studied, tested, and approved through the normal and safest process from the FDA. If you agree with the supporters of this legislation, then I urge you all to contact your congressional delegation and have this done through the FDA, as all medication has to go through. Thank you very much for any questions. Chief, I just have one question. As you know, we've worked together
guns.
Yeah.
Marijuana. This goes on and on and on. This guy's a good guy. I have to tell you that we have got to find a way to balance law enforcement concerns and make this work. I'm not saying this is the right bill. I'm not saying I'm ready to support the bill. I'm just saying that this is the second or third hearing on this issue. I know some of the people involved in this issue. I know that there are dangers of marijuana that we're seeing as it boils over into all sorts of other drugs that are worse. But for some people, and we've seen them this afternoon, being able to smoke medical marijuana works. It does. We know it. And I know you've told me that in many communities across the state, police chiefs are looking the other way, and I salute you for that. I don't know whether you're doing that or not, but I know some are. And but I don't know if this is the right bill. Apparently not from your point of view. I think eventually, sooner rather than later, we've got to find a way to make this work. So that's more of a statement than a question.
Well, I think
I told you that in private, and I'm telling you that in public.
And I think that the answer to that is to, you know, take these, and as you know, I'm very compassionate, and I don't back down from a lot of things. But I think that taking it from Concord, taking it from this building, and putting that down into Washington is what needs to happen. And everybody that's testified here before needs to make that effort and bring this before our congressional delegation and have it studied down there, have it passed down there. And that alleviates all of these other concerns that we have, and it takes it away from that. No police chief, and I haven't talked to anybody who wants to see people suffering and see people who are having to go around, you know, in this kind of thing. But I don't think coming to Concord and legislating that way or in any other state is a proper way. I think it needs to be done through the normal process of medication.
Well, I appreciate that, having been down there. It's not so easy.
Well, I think if we push hard enough, we can get that far.
You've heard me say it in private and in public. I continue to hope that there's a resolution to this that works, whether it's nationwide or New Hampshire. I'm not ready to say 409 is the right way, but it's a lot closer than the bill a year ago. And I will say, I think eventually, sooner rather than later, some medical marijuana legislation is going to pass. We'd be much better off to work together to make do it the right way.
And we'll try to do what we can to do that.
The House just this afternoon voted to decriminalize marijuana. It's coming.
But by one vote.
I know. It's not going to happen today. You see the point I'm making. Any other questions, Senator DeBloyd?
One of the questions I wanted to ask you is if we were to add to this amendment bill that we're discussing today a sunset while we make that waiver to Washington, would that change your position?
I don't believe so, no. I think that simply because I think it needs to come through the FDA has been our position.
And you know how slow Washington works.
Unfortunately, yes.
This could take years.
Probably ought to get started sooner than later.
Exactly. But the people that we're trying to help need to have some benefit now. How would you change this bill to make it satisfactory to allow medical marijuana
I don't think we can.
To be out there?
And the reason being is that if you just think about some of the stuff that is and talked about here over the last hour and a half or so, because of the, I'm not a physician, I'm not a chemist, there's a lot of things that need to be studied about this that unfortunately are going to have to take a little bit of time.
Now, maybe some of the other countries have already done that, so that data may be available to speed up that process. But I think we have to look at how these are going to interact with other medications that these patients are taking and what are the effects of them, so that they, from their doctor and with consultation with their doctor, they know what the effects are. One of the first speakers talked about, and we've all seen them on the things, this medication may cause nausea, may cause it, it's on the TV now. They know that because of the studies that they've done. So there needs to be those so that the doctors can best advise their patients of what the risks are, what the benefits are, and balance those two things out.
Thank you. I'm surprised that you take that side. I'm very surprised that you're off on that tangent. What I really thought that you would zero in on is how the patients are going to get the cannabis by growing it themselves or having a care center grow it for them. And that distribution, I thought you would be more concerned with than being concerned with the effects and the use of the drug.
Well, I want to be brief. There are concerns that we have with that, with it falling into the wrong hands, with the fact that this is one step, for some of the speakers here, I think this is one step closer to the legalization of marijuana. I think they use it, this is a springboard for that. In the hearings that we'll have, now that it's passed the House, they'll be some of the same people testifying in support of the decriminalization bill. But I also think that what we worry about is the abuse. The people that will go in and use this is an excuse. And what I've told Representative Merrick, Senator Forsyth, when we've had discussions before, is that make it as tight as possible so that the sickest and neediest, that's one way to sort of minimize some of those concerns.
Chief, one of the ways that you can stop the blanket decriminalization of marijuana is to cooperate and try to make the distribution of this as tight as possible with us so that people can have the medicine that they need and satisfy law enforcement that the plant is controlled in a manner that can't be available to the general public, therefore not creating a cottage industry.
Well, I think there's two issues through some of the bills that have happened in the past. One of them is putting our state workers at risk for committing a federal offense. That's why this bill has been drafted the way that it was, to keep that out of it. The other part is that I have made those statements as people that are supporting this have said. I've sat down with Representative Merrick in the past, sat down just recently with Senator Forsyth, and talked to them. And one thing that my drumbeat is, I'm not going to support this. It needs to go through the FDA. But if you do draft this, make it as tight as possible. And I've given examples of that and some suggestions. And Senator Forsyth listened to some of those and chose not to take all of them. But it's that balance.
I apologize. A couple things. One is one of the beauties of what goes on in this building, in this room, is that everyone is able to voice their opinion, and that is the beauty of this. So I know it probably isn't easy when you present your view, especially after the young lady who did an incredible job, and it's very emotional, and we want to support everyone who is suffering in our communities, and I'm sure that you do too. But you do take an oath to uphold the law. And I think that when you mentioned, could we work on getting this to Washington and making a change, you're really talking about the FDA and going through the FDA so that this drug goes through the same process as other drugs. However, I think the problem and what slows us down, and the problem with it is the stigma about this particular drug. And I was just wondering if someone in your position would be able to help with changing that stigma and treating this as a drug that could go through the FDA. You see what I'm saying? It's that it's impossible when you've got the stigma attached to it, and what can you do in your position to address that issue?
Well, I think by distinguishing the two things. I mean, we have, you know, the opiates, you know, that we're seeing killing people in our state right now, prescription opiates that are doing that. You know, they've been able to, because the FDA has put those out there, other things. You know, Oxycontin isn't called heroin. But if you look at it, it's very similar to that, and probably, again, I'm not a chemist, so I don't know, you know, all the particulars about it, but I think there is a way to do that, but because the FDA has gone through that, that's the process. I think looking at it, and you know, you can always, you know, expand things. It's very hard to restrict it once it's out, the old genie in the bottle analogy. So I think making it, you know, tight as possible, but again, I'm a firm believer that if enough people reach out to, you know, our congressional delegation and say, this is what it is, this is what needs to happen, if they hear from enough, I think that will have an effect. You know, I think that's what makes our country great, is we can, we're people of the government, and we can, you know, go through that without having all these other things. I think it's very difficult when the same people who are testifying in support of medical marijuana are also testifying in support of decriminalization, because that's truly how they feel about it. That creates, you know, some problems, I think, in some respect, because they lose that credibility. But we've got a lot of people here that we won't see on decriminalization.
Senator Sanborn.
Thank you, sir. Chief, thanks for coming down. As you know, Craig family and my family go way back in the Upper Valley.
Yes.
Way back. You guys are a great family, you're wonderful people. And what I love is that we share those true traditions and anchor values that are so important to us. And with all due respect to Congressman Bradley, all due respect to the world, do you want to put the future of this state of the people in the hands of D.C. or in the hands of the people of New Hampshire? And I'd submit to you that I think the people of New Hampshire have a much clearer understanding of what is important to us. And you know, I know you worked with Senator Forsyth, he's my office mate, he's tried very hard to make a good bill, a bunch of other people. And I hear you talk about how the FDA is a big hurdle for you. And that's a big hurdle for all of us. So I ask if you would consider continuing to work with them. I think you guys have come pretty close on some issues, and there might only be a couple of what we call hanging chads, I guess, that might need to work. And I understand you're in a real tough spot. We all get that. And we're all in a tough spot with this one. And I really ask you to sit down with Senator Forsyth again and see if you guys can find some way to find some level of comfort.
I'm always willing to work with that. I don't see, I see hurdles differently. Upbringing, I think with hard work you can, you know, get results. So I see Washington, yeah, there's, you know, the senators obviously been there, but I think with enough people who work on that, that's the route that really needs to go. And I think that'll serve our people better than what's being proposed here today.
Really appreciate the consideration.
Thank you.
Chief, thank you very much. Always a pleasure. He is one of the best guys. I can attest to that.
I know we all can beat the light out of you, but you're awesome. You guys are awesome.
Thank you.
Now it's your turn, Ms. Echol.
With a sigh.
Karen Echol from the Attorney General's Office.
Thank you, Senator, Mr. Chair, and members of the committee. Thank you for taking my testimony today. I am Karen Echol from the Attorney General's Office. And I represent the Attorney General on this bill. And as I'm sure you are aware, the Attorney General opposes the legalization of marijuana for medicinal purposes. First, and we know that there are legal barriers. That's the first problem. And we know what the legal barriers are. Federal law won't allow the treatment of raw marijuana as a medicine. That means doctors can't prescribe it, pharmacies can't dispense it or sell it. No one can sell it. The FDA has not yet approved, found that it's safe and effective. Efforts to remove these barriers, as we've already been talking, need to start at the federal level. because these are problems that are in the way, and they need to be, the first thing that needs to happen is that marijuana needs to be rescheduled from Schedule 1 to Schedule 2, so then the research can take place. I think everyone agrees that there hasn't been enough research done on the medical use of raw marijuana in its raw form. They have taken effort, steps to provide a THC alternative to the raw form. And there's another, I believe there's another drug that's being studied right now, another THC-based synthetic drug. In any case, at this point right now, the federal government, they have, and they are arresting people for cultivating marijuana. And if, when, and where they decide to exercise that authority is outside the reach or the power of any state legislature. They have the authority to come in and do that. The law has survived constitutional scrutiny, so we know they can do it if they want to. We just don't know. But we do know that they are doing it. So that is certainly a barrier. A problem. And you have heard about the teen use. Certainly we are concerned. For some reason, teen use of marijuana is higher in New Hampshire than it is in our surrounding states. It's been that way for a while. Don't know why that is, but we have a bigger problem than Massachusetts or Vermont or Maine. I don't know why, but we do feel that this type of legislation will bolster the perception that marijuana is safe. And we know from the National Institute on Drug Abuse 2010 survey that New Hampshire kids rank very, very high in the top three, I think, for teen use of marijuana and perception of harm, low perception of harm. So there is a correlation. When you think something's safe, you're more likely to try it. Again, I don't know why that is true in New Hampshire, but it is. Fourth, we don't have the state resources to administer and enforce an orderly system of providing an otherwise illegal drug to the truly sick. Haven't figured out how to do it. No state has really figured out how to do it. That's why every single time you see a piece of legislation, it's different. It changes. It changes. It's always different because no state has really figured out how to do this because the legal and medical issues surrounding the use of medical marijuana in this context are far from settled. That is really the state of the issue. With all due respect to the sponsors of the bill and all of the people that testified before, and also the compassionate purpose behind the bill, that's certainly recognized. It's not time for this bill. These are the reasons that the Attorney General would respectfully urge you to reject
I'm happy to answer any questions.
Questions? Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate it. Other laws where New Hampshire and federal statutes conflict, but yet we still live with them?
This is not that I can think of off the top of my head where. Well, first of all, they don't yet. I mean, this will pass.
I apologize.
Right. I can't think of any at the moment. Other states have other issues like immigration, trying to enforce immigration issues, and some states are passing those to the state laws. And there's a question there whether that's an area of federal control or state. Can states get involved in that? But I can't think of how long it falls in this category.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Wallace. you. I'm John Wallace, representing the Department of Health and Human Services here, not to speak for or against the bill, but to indicate that over the past several years, as we've worked through various groups of this, our perspective has been trying to get a bill that we view as workable from the department that carries out, or it would be responsible for carrying out most of the administrative duties attached to it. And I have to say, this version is better than the earlier ones, which were problematic in many ways from my standpoint. There are many compelling stories from a policy standpoint that's good, and I, like many others, have had friends who have had serious medical problems where they assert to me that the only thing that has helped them is marijuana. Now, whether or not we can get to a bill which satisfies everyone, which has the kinds of controls and limits, I don't know, but I'm here to try to work towards that end. The scope of the responsibility which we have, we have to issue the cards, we have to get the affidavits that the people have, send those out, issue photo ID cards, have some process for that. For the patients and then the caregivers, there are criminal background checks, have to process cards, updates, control numbers that have to be issued and reissued. We have to have a system for where law enforcement can verify the status of somebody, probably 24/7, because it talks about if they're stopped or arrested. So you want, they want to verify that there's somebody who's authorized to have marijuana in possession. So we have to have a system for that, which is probably some kind of computerized system. We have to issue reports to the legislature, and there are certain other duties about fines and controls. And so there is a not an inconsiderable amount of work that we would have to do with this. And there are no resources in the bill directed to us to accomplish those. What is in the bill is a provision that says we can take donations, and which is fine. Have to have donations. But whether or not we would be able to get sufficient donations in the year that we have to get this up and running, get those on the books, to hire people to carry this out, I'm not sure. There is a default position in here, if you have read the bill, the default position being that if we don't get this up and running in the year, then a person may possess this simply by doing an affidavit, notarized affidavit, saying, I meet all the criteria. So there is that position there, so you're aware of it. We are also responsible for setting fees prospectively, right? The number of people who do that, that would be sufficient to cover the expenses of the program. Now, we have some people estimating, and I don't know if this is the way to play out, that it would take two staff members to run this year-round, and then about $85,000 to set up the computer system and all of that. So a couple hundred thousand dollars first year, and then $125,000 or so continuously after that to operate the program. I don't really know whether it's half that or that amount, whatever, but whatever it is, we would have to anticipate what number of people would do that and try to set a fee which would bring in enough money to run that program. Earlier, I thought I could have mentioned of 100 people statewide, maybe that would meet your criteria. I don't know what that would be. But you can see that's going to have to be a fairly substantial fee to get that going. Now, they anticipate donations that are going to get this down, but I don't know how it's going to work. All I want to say to you is we need some mechanism up front that would allow us to have the resources to meet our responsibilities going forward. And if that is simply waiting until we get sufficient donations that we bring on the books to hire people, so be it. And that would be the way. But I would think you may want to think of something a little more affirmative in terms of ensuring that we'd be able to carry out our duties. there is a provision in here which concerns me about breaches of confidential information. It criminalizes it, makes it a misdemeanor to do that. I can tell you we have substantial amounts of confidential information about hundreds of thousands of people, which we have every day, people with AIDS, people with mental illnesses, people with all kinds of disorders. And nowhere in any of these things is a breach of confidentiality a criminal matter. If that is left in there, I can assure you that I would advise anybody who might work this program not to do it. There is a provision that says we are supposed to verify for somebody who is a landlord, a healthcare person, an employer, whether or not a person in the card is valid, which in effect is the disclosure of confidential information. If somebody calls in and says, I need a landlord, or something like that, and it is a crime for us to disclose that to somebody who's not authorized, that part of the system doesn't work. So I would urge you not to make that breach a criminal matter. There's another provision where it says that the fingerprints that get submitted have to be destroyed after they've been criminal background check has been run. Now, since we presume that there are going to be renewals of this and everything, it doesn't seem to me make a lot of sense to keep getting new fingerprints and destroy them each year through that process. I understand the desire for confidentiality, but if you're going to do that, at least make it optional for the person submitting them not to have to go. We have done that. Fiscal note, the latest amendment came to us somewhat late in the game, so we just got a few days ago, and it turned around. The estimate is that a couple $100,000 the first year to get up and run, to hire the people and get the computer system in place, and about $125,000 a year thereafter. As I look at that, I'm thinking, because they're telling me we can get computer systems from other states and everything, that might be a little high. It's kind of one person's guess versus another's, but I don't know.
Now, obviously, you're one of those guys that understands we're broke.
Well, we do not have the ability to
this. So if they could find the capacity to give the donations up front and make it some for self-funding, you guys might go find some level of comfort with that.
If you have things saying that this, our obligations go into effect once we have enough money to run it, or something that allows us to actually get some money on the books and hire somebody to actually do this work and to buy the system and get it installed and figure out how we're going to get access out there in a way that people can't hack into, but police can get it readily and on. There's some technical things, but as I say, there is a default position in U.S. staff, which is if we don't get it up and running in a year, people can possess it legally through a different means that's in the end of this.
I'm just not sure I'm comfortable with that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Anyone else?
Thank you. Major Conti.
Thank you very much, Senator, members of the committee, for having me here. I have been here before on this issue, and we do stand in opposition. I'm here to represent the Department of Safety. My name is Russ Conti, and I'm a major with the State Police, and have so been for them for 27 years. I also want to make note that we do have compassion for the testimony we heard today. Certainly, we do not want to contribute to pain and suffering, and I do feel and respect the people who testified today. Dear honorable members of the committee, this bill allows possession, distribution, and use of marijuana for medicinal purposes. The bill shows an awareness of the problems these laws have created in other states and makes a valiant effort to circumvent them. However, the Department of Safety still must oppose the bill. We believe this bad policy will create more problems than it solves. First of all, despite what might happen if the bill passes, marijuana possession will still be illegal under federal law. The United States Supreme Court has ruled in the case of Ashcroft v. Rouse that people who use marijuana for medical purposes can be prosecuted under the Federal Controlled Substances Act, even if they are using it pursuant to a doctor's prescription and if such usage is legal under state law. Therefore, this bill creates a situation where a person is allowed to do something under state law that would make him or her, frankly, a criminal under federal law. Secondly, despite how carefully written this bill is, it can constitute the first step down a very slippery slope. Based on experience of other states, this law will create a booming business in production and distribution of a drug that will become a highly competitive marketplace. Marijuana producers will try to see if it produced the most potent crop and advertise it as such. THC, the psychoactive ingredient in marijuana, varies greatly from one producer to another. It is not like alcohol, where the blood level content clearly indicates a level of impairment. Or prescription drugs, where a doctor prescribing a certain number of milligrams of the drug can accurately predict what is a safe or not a safe dose. Persons with medical marijuana prescriptions will have the substance in their houses where their teenage sons and daughters may have access to it. The pill for you, sell to friends, etc. There are enough problems in our highways already with drivers misusing prescription drugs. And yes, that is a scourge, not only in this state, but nationwide. Driving under the influence of those drugs and getting into crashes. This will provide yet another danger on the road. In Los Angeles, the business took off so quickly and became so competitive that there are hundreds of medical marijuana outlets in the city. The city council has been looking for a way to place a cap on the number of places that will be allowed. They're becoming as familiar sites as Walgreens Pharmacy, and in some cases, they even hold tastings to tout their product, similar to wine tastings that vendors use to promote wine sales. And we're not saying that New Hampshire, Los Angeles are directly in line, but these are extreme examples. Unethical physicians are giving up their regular practices and specializing in issuing prescriptions for medical marijuana. Undercover officers are going to these places posing as customers and claiming some mild ailment, such as a cold, which would clearly be an illegal use of medical marijuana. And the provider will ask, but surely you must have a pain someplace else. The buyer will catch the hint, and the buyer suddenly thinks they have a painful groin, painful stomach, or some other pain. And the practitioner will write a prescription, and that person is off and on his or her way. Officers in Colorado and in Montana have experienced the same scenario. Even if the bill passes, there will be many people suddenly describing symptoms of severe pain, severe nausea, severe vomiting, resistant muscle spasms, and peddling the drug will be such a lucrative business that it will be tempting to write the prescription and look the other way. Law enforcement contacts in Montana describe their experience with a similar law as a virtual nightmare. They have legislation pending to put more controls in place, but they say it is very difficult to put the toothpaste back in the tube. Montana is very similar in size and culture in terms of population, economics, and ethnic backgrounds, and quite often uses a comparison. One of Montana's distributors is ironically named the Healing Center, also known as THC. They have a website you can visit. Currently, Montana has a stunning 25,000 card-carrying citizens that are allowed to have medical marijuana out of a population of less than 950,000 total citizens. A similar percentage could be extrapolated in New Hampshire if this bill passes. One of every 33 New Hampshire citizens could be expected to possess these cards, allowing them to purchase and use marijuana. There are also significant issues involving federally insured banks in states that have passed similar legislation. In Colorado, for example, banks have refused to do business with dispensaries due to the fact that the drug is illegal under federal law, and processing transactions or investments with marijuana puts federally insured banks at risk of facing racketeering drug charges. Most of the business as a result require cash only, making them a prime target for armed robbery. You can imagine the possibility of coming away with both drugs and cash from the same robbery. In California, federal prosecutors have warned building owners who lease space to dispensaries that they face forfeiture and possible criminal charges if the dispensaries remain in operation. It is likely that New Hampshire would face similar risks if the bill passes. The bill also requires designated caregivers and alternative treatment centers agents to submit the state and federal criminal record checks through the Department of Safety Criminal Records Unit. The bill also requires the Department of Health and Human Services to do a background for each voluntary to determine if there are any drug-related convictions. These sections appear to be in conflict with federal law governing access to the FBI criminal history database for non-criminal justice purposes. The law requires a specific reason for the FBI to process fingerprint cards through the database. It is unclear who is required to capture the fingerprint images and whether there is a fee. Finally, there would be an additional staffing requirement needed to process these requests. The bill outlines a list of places and circumstances where the drug might not be permitted. This is flawed because it says a cardholder can be arrested or prosecuted for certain violations, but it does not specifically permit a private employer or a government agency from prohibiting an employee from using the drug. It says that they could be arrested, but there is no such crime to arrest them for. So if you smell marijuana wafting through a state park like Alicoya or at a public park like workplace, it could happen. It could be trouble. This is an extremely troubling bill. The risk the changes the face of New Hampshire and not for the better. So the Department of Safety does oppose it.
Thank you. Questions of the major? Seeing none.
Thank you very much.
We have a few more people that have signed up to speak. Bob Constantine.
I see this as three issues, kind of all rolled in one. There's the substance itself, there are the legal issues, and there are the liberty issues. As far as the substance itself, I have a lot of things that I'll hand in. Some of them have already been discussed, so I won't go over them too much. But as far as lung cancer, I think one of the police officers mentioned that. That's been refuted recently by the most recent reports, the Tashkin report, Yale Medical Journal in 2007, and most recently in 2012, January. Another extensive medical report was done that refutes that. So I respectfully say that Chief Craig is wrong. As far as the gateway, there's no gateway. The University of New Hampshire, University of Pittsburgh, recently did studies on that. Who supports safe access to medical marijuana? Well, some of the information I'll hand in, I will detail that there are 81% of the American public supports that. It's far safer than tobacco and alcohol. I have a copy of the United States patent for the neuroprotectants and cannabinoids, which is one of the active ingredients. It is encompasses most of the active ingredients in cannabis or marijuana. It's United States patent number 6,630,507. I'll give you a copy of that. As far as Judge Francis Young, somebody said, oh, this needs to be studied. No, it really doesn't, because it's been studied for thousands of years. Judge Francis Young, who's an administrative law judge, in 1988, it's been going on for a while. We all know that. He was overseeing a study, and what he found was, in strict medical terms, marijuana is far safer than many foods we commonly consume. In practical terms, marijuana cannot induce a lethal response result of drug-related toxicity. The reason it remains illegal for recreational use, medical use, and all that, we all know they're political reasons. They're not real reasons. I'm going to submit that. As far as the federal government, this is one example of them speaking out of both sides of their mouth. The other is the patent that I just mentioned. Also, there's something called the Compassionate Investigational Drug Program. That's something that's been going on since 1976. There are several people in this country that the federal government has been providing cannabis to for medical reasons. I'm going to submit that also. That's something. I know you guys are going to stay up tonight reading all this stuff, so I won't bore you with all of the really good parts. Also, I'm going to submit a map. You might recognize that from eighth grade geography. That's the United States, 48 states. recognize that little gray area there, the live free or die state. It's surrounded by all of these other colored states that enjoy a more increased measure of freedom than we do. I won't belabor that, but I'm going to submit that also. About 21 and a half million people have been arrested since 1965 for cannabis-related crimes. It's about 850,000 a year recently. It's about 97.5 an hour. It's not really good. That's why we have the most people in this country in jail than any country in the world. I did 40 days at the Grafton County Correctional Facility for trying to grow anthemas. It's not good. One of the cops told me, actually two, this is ridiculous. He said, you're a good guy. He didn't want to arrest me. But he did. And I spent 40 days. So I had a lot of time to think about this. As far as the legal issues, Schedule 1, what Schedule 1 says, this is the way the Fed schedule, you might know this already. It says that there can be no accepted medical use anywhere in the United States. Well, here comes the doublespeak. Remember, this is the 48 states. It's accepted in the United States. It's been used medically since 4800 BC. The last issue that I want to touch on are the liberty issues. What it really comes down to is those people who are here against this, they're here because they're supporting their job. Maybe they have different opinions privately, maybe they don't. Maybe they're just uninformed. But they're here because a paycheck tells them. I'm here because I believe that I own myself, he owns himself, and she owns herself. I think this war on drugs has gone on way too long. It started as a racist war. Some of you may or may not know that. I think it's very hypocritical that in a state that sells $534 million worth of alcohol, people like me, I coached baseball with you in Wolf Project about 15 years ago. Okay? I'm a good guy. I put in time, volunteer and all. I risk losing my house. A friend of mine, she just reported to jail for 2 to 4 years. The feds confiscated her house. She had to ransom it back because she thought she owned herself. She thought she could grow medical marijuana and get away with it. It's time. It's really time. And you need to do this. A lot of other information. You asked some questions, sir. Senator Sanborn?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Concerning any conflicts with the feds, Article 7, New Hampshire Constitution would probably iron that one out for you. You asked about cost for the gentleman from Health and Human Services. I can tell you there's a tremendous human cost. Tremendous. The law itself conflicts with itself in New Hampshire. I won't belabor this, but I did a 91A hearing over at Merrimack County Superior Court. I asked while I was preparing for my trial, because I did take it to trial, because I didn't say I did it because of philosophical reasons. I asked to see the published controlled drug schedule in New Hampshire, because as we all know, the Commissioner of Health and Human Services, you know, knows all of his many duties he's supposed to do and complies with the one. Well, he didn't do that. He never showed it to the hearing either. So the law in New Hampshire conflicts with itself. I know it quite well. It's a really long law. There's a lot of things, but I could belabor this. I won't. If any of you are really interested in that, it's an exciting story, but it's never even been published according to statutory construction, which is your RSA 2132. They just refer you to a federal website. It's RSA 2132, statutory construction. It's supposed to be published in the newspaper on a regular basis. If you look all through 318B2, which is the law itself, I won't get into too much, but if you want to contact me after that, I'll get all the details. As far as other commentary, and I'll be brief because I know we want to get out of here. Chief Crates is worried about the genie being out of the bottle. Well, 114 million Americans have already admitted to using cannabis. 81% of Americans say, hey, let's just let people, these are a lot of people who don't use cannabis, let's let people have medical marijuana. So the genie is way out of the bottle. A major, he said it's not like alcohol. He's absolutely right. Alcohol can kill you. It's therapeutically impossible for cannabis to do. Got a lot of other stuff I was going to get into, but I know we all are tired, so I'll submit this, and if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you very much, Bob.
All right.
Questions?
Good to see you, Jeff.
Thank you. I would next recognize Brad.
Greg.
I'll decline. I respect everybody's time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Rich Angle. Good afternoon, sir.
Thank you, and thank you for having me here. My name is Rich Angel. I came here straight from a greenhouse in Grafton, still in farmer's attire. I almost put down Farmer Rich on the sign-in sheet, but I didn't have any ideas about what I might be growing. I can assure you that I'm not growing anything illegal, and if I were, I wouldn't tell you about it. I did put on the sign-up sheet that I'm representing the Declaration of Independence. And so I would like to leave you today with a quote from Dr. Benjamin Rush, who was one of the signers of the Declaration of Independence and who ended up not being directly involved with the Constitution, the U.S. Constitution. He said, and I quote to the best of my ability or paraphrase, he said that if freedom of medicine is not written into the Constitution, it will only be a matter of time before medicine or the medical industry organizes to form an underground dictatorship. And I think that what we're seeing today, the so-called war on drugs, which is really a war on people, prescription laws, which put people behind bars, licensure laws, and so on, are living or dead proof that Dr. Benjamin was right. And anything that we can do to reverse that trend and return the freedom of medicine to where it belongs, and that is to say, the individual and his or her doctor, can only be a good step in the right direction. Once the government and their corporate accomplices are in a position of telling us what we can or can't, or should or shouldn't put in our own bodies, I contend that tyranny has already commenced, and now it's only a matter of degrees.
Thank you, Mr. Engel. Any questions?
Angel.
I'm sorry.
You said his angle was liberty. His name is Angel.
Well,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have two more people that I'm not sure if they wish to speak or not, but Carrie Olson. Or Kathy Bonus. Apparently they're not here. Have I missed anybody that wishes to speak a first time? Yes, sir.
I would like to make a point.
To expand Bill Allen from where? To expand very briefly on Bob Constantine's point. My total of speakers today is something over 20, and there were three who spoke against this bill. All of them paid employees of the executive branch with a vested interest. And a rhetorical question to you is simply, do you represent the executive branch, or do you represent the people?
Thank you, Mr. Allen. Anyone else? First time? Second time? In that case, I'm going to close the hearing. I would urge the sponsors to work with the Department of Safety and the Department of Health and Human Services. If you wish to propose an amendment.
I'll meet with HHS.
Okay. Very good. We will probably, this has got an FN, so I think we have to exec it next week. Is that correct?
Yes.
brought up. All right, so, Jim, you've got your marching orders. We only have